But in financial aid, you know, the smartest people at the colleges, we knew that this is really a financial conversation. And if we weren't having the right financial conversation with students, they will leave. You heard Amy Ellen talk about some of the reasons students leave is financial. And most folks think that means financial aid, but it means financial. They leave to work, they have to, you know, they have families to support. And so we knew that if we made this a financial conversation, we can get a little bit more buy-in from the students and from the families, but then having more direct individual relationships with students. So once we actually implemented the program and really helped students think about the public benefits as a part of their financial aid, we really redetermined and redefined what financial aid was at our institution and having the financial education conversation with students. We were able to tie the public benefits into our financial education. So we do a lot of one-on-one counseling with students about what's a Pell Grant, how do you keep your Pell Grant, what are the requirements around not just enrollment, but there's academic requirements around Pell Grant in terms of progression and completion and completion rates, how they borrow loans and how they repay loans. But what we're hoping to do at that point was to really help students think to reduce their student debt in terms of borrowing loans, but apply for temporary public benefits while they're enrolled. And that was really important for Ohio because in 2008, our state, our Ohio Board of Regents, our state had decided at that time that community colleges were so inexpensive, the direct cost, I guess, of community colleges were so inexpensive that they did not need to receive the state grant anymore. Only the private and public universities would receive that, and the proprietary universities as well, but not the community colleges, because those students were likely to receive Pell. Now certainly I mentioned most of my students did receive Pell, but that was the state's thinking around that. But what we saw from 2008 to 2013 was at our institution a skyrocket in student loan borrowing. Very dramatic. And then keep in mind you're talking about borrowing for students who are very low income. So repayment is quite difficult. So when you think about community colleges and how the completion rates are for some students, if students are completing, they borrow student loans that they cannot repay anyway because they're likely in the same financial situation because they've not completed. So they don't have a degree to advance to the next position. So it's this whole cycle that we thought about from our initiative perspective and why it was really important to help students reduce their student loan debt and to apply for public benefits, which we knew they should be qualified for based on what we knew about their income. So we really had to think about the positioning in our institution and really the buy-in in our institution. We have 44,000 students annually. That's a lot of students for the financial aid office to get their arms around. So we really had to work strategically with everyone across the campus, and primarily our faculty. It had to be in the classroom, and faculty had to have those tough conversations. Amy Ellen kind of mentioned Gateway was really interested in trying to focus in their community. It was tough for us to get faculty to think about having that conversation with students. One, they thought it was a little bit intrusive, maybe a little bit sensitive discussion with students. And then there's some political components that they didn't really want to talk about because they didn't believe in public benefits. So we had people to think that these are not public benefits in the way that is focused on helping students take advantage or folks take advantage of the system. It's really about helping students complete. And so we tied it to our success initiatives. And once we were able to get everybody to think about how our students have various needs around, because we deal with a lot of homeless students, we deal with a lot of under-resourced students, and we deal with a lot of students who certainly need childcare and benefits related to healthcare. So we have enrollment, Enroll America is on our campus every week, helping students apply for healthcare right on campus. But our first notion was really about helping students reduce their thinking around student loan debt and applying for public benefits to kind of offset that unmet need and looking at it in that way. So we spent some time surveying our students and asking how we could implement this on campus. Where does it fit? Where is the best fit? We worked very closely with our career services departments in making sure they understood when students come to them and they're trying to find jobs, it's because they have this financial need and have an opportunity for us to help them get some of these short-term benefits as well. So the challenge was, how do you get students to opt into this process? How do you get students to take the time? Because it's certainly easier to apply for a student loan than it is to go through the complexity, as Amy Ellen mentioned, in terms of applying for public benefits. But how do you get students to really opt in? So the way we made it a part of our financial aid process and really integrating it into the financial aid process, students believed that they had to at least go through a process to opt out versus opting in. And it took some time for us to get there. That certainly wasn't easy. There was lots of ways in our implementation we finally figured that out. And certainly working with some of the colleagues that were part of the Benefits Access for College Completion Initiative. But now students actually, when they complete the FAFSA application and their records are available in our system, they apply through our student portal to see, they do what we call a quick check to see if they're eligible for public benefits right on our website and our portal. And once they actually get that quick check, we can tell what benefits they may be eligible for, and then we connect them to a group of folks that are new to us in terms of an initiative. Again, came out of how we developed the grant. They're called peer financial coaches. And our peer financial coaches are work study students who help students apply for public benefits and complete financial aid information. And the reason the peer financial coaches was so important to us is we know the peer-to-peer model works. We've had it at our institution for about 16 years. And we call them student ambassadors at the time. And they were really helping students around enrollment initiatives. But when we moved to the model for peer financial coaches, we also had students who were peer financial coaches who knew a lot about benefits. That was certainly a plus for us because they were users of a lot of different services. But they were able to help connect students to the benefits very directly in our office in one-on-one counseling sessions. We also had some group workshops as well, but we found that the one-on-one was a lot more meaningful for students. We were able to integrate the public benefits in the financial aid office, from my perspective, very seamlessly. So when a student comes to financial aid, you don't know if they're coming for a scholarship, a Pell Grant, or public benefits, and that was really our intention. We wanted to make sure students felt some confidence that their information is anonymous. We initially started off in a department that was just separate from financial aid, and it was only for public benefits. But the problem with that, there was no integration. There was nothing driving the students to that department. We knew that they came to financial aid, we can drive the conversation around financial education and then throwing the public benefits into the mix there. Some of our challenges was how do you really get everybody at the institution to buy in? And I can't say that we've done that today, and we've been doing this for several years now. I can't say everybody's bought into it, but I do think it's always about having a conversation, focusing on our initiatives around social justice. During the time in which we started the initiative, at our institution, we changed presidents. And I just will say from our perspective, is we were really fortunate that both were really focused on social justice and equity. And so from going from one president that's been to college for like 20-something years, really focused on this initiative and really helping us when we launched it, and transitioning to a new president who was very familiar with the college, came back to us after being gone for 10 years, serving as presidents of other colleges with a very similar focus on social justice. And now we have at our institution that we launched this past year, a whole initiative at the institution focused on equity and social justice, and really focused on how do we really help. And Amy Ellen had some data about how African American students advance and how Hispanic students advance, and that's really what it's focused on. And being really intentional about looking at our numbers and trying to tell that story about how our students persist. But we thought that from public benefits perspective, it was more than just the financial part of how students receive these benefits and actually matriculate because of the indirect cost, but also about how the students actually persist. And so we tied it to some of our completion initiatives in a way that helped us to measure student success and completion. So we do look at data around how students complete if they have public benefits before they came to us versus those who may have already had them. The challenge sometimes, though, is knowing if they already had them is that they answer the question on the FAFSA application, which they could have completed, many months ago. And is that current and relevant when they actually come to the institution? They completed the FAFSA in March, they started the institution in August. Is there a gap in there to where they still may or may not have benefits? So we do ask some of those questions to try to pare that out. What we want to know is, have we helped them by applying for benefits, and has that helped them be successful and complete? And that's just important to us so that we understand why this work is so important. And then we look at how we help students to continue to complete and be reauthorized for their benefits, because as Amy Allen said, there's various agencies that you're working with and the timelines in which they can reapply for SNAP or reapply for childcare, they're all different. So you gotta make sure you help the students then to try to get on the right timelines and do all their reauthorizations and recertifications so there's no lapse. We've done some things, Amy Allen made me think about some of the work we've done with helping students to find a part-time job so they can meet that 20-hour a week requirement to receive some benefits. And what we've done is help students who are very interested in working on campus with work-study positions that they can work at least 20 hours a week. And so we've been able to identify departments that can help us with some of the attendance requirements around that, because you have to explain to the agencies that the students are enrolled at least 12 credit hours and they are working at least 20 hours to receive certain benefits. And so we have some faculty who are willing to help us with that, and we have some departments that's willing to help us with that. So we hope we continue with the Work Study program in terms of helping continue to recruit more students. We have a pretty modest Work Study program in terms of the funding level that we have with that. But certainly we know around Work Study how that also impacts student retention. So we believe it's important to help us to continue those funding levels.